up here in the front spot, in the front half of the room. So for those who can't hear me because my voice is not that great today, the SSID that we're going to connect to is just SUSE, not the SUSE OS training that's across the hall, but just SUSE, and the password is OpenStack, all one word, lowercase. Yeah, there we go. Whew. All right. Now let's try this again and see if this works. Look at that. First try. That's right. Huzzah is right. Okay. surprised we have this many people here for the last session of the entire conference. I'm glad this is going to be great. Yay. Yay, because the conference is great, not because it's over. Although my wife will be very happy to see me this evening.
Okay. Hey, at least you get to see your wife. I got a plane ride to go.
All right. All right, good afternoon. I guess we don't have a clicker.
So. Everybody say cheese.
Cheese.
Good choice.
All right. Thank you for coming to our little thing. And wow, those lights are bright. Okay, let's look at this side of the room. Not because I don't like you guys, but because I'm not blinded when I look over here. So today what we're going to do is we're going to do a little bit of service orchestration. This is a very basic introduction to Heat. Who here has actually worked with Heat before and tried to do templates and stuff like that? Okay, so those of you who, how many of you were successful at doing so? Okay, a lot more, okay. Those of you who are in that boat, you're probably not going to get a whole lot out of this. I'll be upfront with you right there. This is very basic, just standing up instances, creating basic resources, and connecting them together. You're more than welcome to stay and to do that. I just wanted to let you know ahead of time so you didn't get into this and then realize that, no, I already know all this, and I could have been spending my whole time going and getting tacos.
Tacos and beer and tequila. Sure. And more tacos.
All right. So by way of introduction, my name is Rick Ashford. I am a senior technology strategist. I just made that up today. Not really, I stole my coworker's title because I thought it sounded good. for SUSE, I've been doing this for about coming up on 8 years now. With me here is Sean Rickard, who is, 3 years?
3 years, yes.
3 years here at SUSE, all doing the same thing. Our jobs are to work with our customers to help them understand the technologies and everything that we do. And so part of that is doing classes like this. Sean is based out of Montreal. I'm actually based about 20 miles up the road here in Round Rock. So I welcome all of you to our wonderful city. If you have any questions about where you want to go for dinner tonight, I have lots of good suggestions for you. do not waste your time at Taco Bell or McDonald's or Wendy's or something like that. That's a shame. Shame on you if you do that while you're in this town. All right. All right. So all that kind of fun stuff out of the way. We're going to do a very quick, brief overview of of just Heat, what it is. All that kind of stuff, some of the history, and then we'll get into a little bit of the syntax for for creating stuff, and then we're going to dive right in from there into the actual lab work. I'll give you a URL that you can use to pull down the materials to do the labs. So, Heat is all about deployment of services for being able to do something, right? Typically, you know, you don't normally have just like a single application on a single server that you're launching up one at a time. Usually it's a series of things that need to be done in concert in order to provide an overall service. There's three different ways that I want to talk about that you can deploy services in cloud. The easy way, the not quite as easy way, and then the hard up front, but totally easier, and then end way.
And there's some good news. We're actually going to be doing all three today.
To some extent, yeah. Okay. The very first one, the easy way, how do I deploy it? Just log into the dashboard, click the button to launch an instance, create your stuff. That's one of the beauties of OpenStack and cloud computing in general, is that you can very quickly and easily go in and point and click your way to a functioning environment. And that's okay. You know, for some people, that's the way to go. They don't need to learn other stuff. That's great. But you know, sometimes you need, as I said, the Heat is usually, you know, the services are typically not just one thing. You have multiple resources you need to do together. Oftentimes you have to repeat it because you need different instances to do different tasks. And as a result, you want something that's a repeatable process so that you don't have people constantly misconfiguring their systems when they're supposed to be bringing them up. So the not quite as easy way, there's a wonderful API for OpenStack. There's lots of command line tools you can go through. You can write your scripts, and you can script out and essentially do manual installs, but do it from a scripting standpoint. And that takes a little bit of time and effort to get into it. But once you do that, it's very easy to keep rerunning that script. one of the downsides, though, is this is not terribly friendly to all your potential cloud users. I don't know about you, but I spent a lot of time in my professional career working with people that did not care for a command line. My own mother actually liked the command line better than my customers did. That's cheating a little bit because my dad was a 40-year IBMer and has been doing did Linux for like a long time. But most of your end users don't like the command line. You know, Bob in finance, he needs to be able to run his application or his WordPress blog or whatever. He does not care to log into a Linux terminal and issue some sort of commands to execute a script. Not going to belabor that point anymore. So the hard up front, but totally easier in the end way, is Heat itself. It takes a little bit of time to get used to it. I'll be quite up front. It's very difficult to find good documentation that you understand and good examples. There have been, I'll get to you in just a second, sir. There have been lots of people who have done piecemeal tutorials here and there, and as long as you use the specific technologies that they did in the specific way that they did, those work very well. But when you're trying to adapt stuff and get it to be and get it to be customized to your needs, there's a lot of work that still needs to be done. It's much better than it was. I've been teaching this course now for, this is probably the third year, second or third year that I've been doing this. And the documentation has improved dramatically over that period of time, so this is less true now than it was, but it is still a little bit difficult. But once you get past that barrier and you get the understanding for it, it makes it very quick and easy. And you have a simple script, a simple page. You can tell people just load this into your dashboard, and go. And once you know, we're not integrating that here. But if you use Murano or one of these application catalogs, that takes it one step further. Where it becomes your push button app store. Sir, you had a question here in the front. These slides are not only going to be available, but I'm going to give you the URL for my laptop if you're on there, and it has all the materials for the class in there, lab materials, some additional stuff that you can play with on your own time if you want to do. For example, there's an auto-scaling template for Apache that you're more than welcome to run. It has a KVM image for it, which is a downside because I don't have a KVM hypervisor up here, so you're not going to be able to do that here. But you're more than welcome to take it with you and do that. And the slides will be in there as well. Marketing would probably prefer if I export that as a PDF before I turn that over to you. So I will create the PDF momentarily. Yeah. Dry mouth. Where did my water go? I was around here somewhere. It's where?
I don't know.
Oh, right here in the front, of course.
I don't know if anybody else has fallen victim to the pollen here, but I definitely have. So I apologize for my very raspy voice.
All right, yeah. I was seriously worried about whether I was going to be able to do this morning. Even as early as this morning, I was not really able to talk above a whisper. But we're doing good now. Yay. Okay, so Heat. It's been around since Grizzly. This is when it was started being an incubator project, so it's got a little bit of history now. And then we here at SUSE have been supporting it since the Havana release. Once it kind of got out of the incubation period, we felt like that at that point it was ready to be able to be supported. So just by way of reference, that was in SUSE OpenStack Cloud 3.0, where we just released our 6.0 version based off of Liberty a couple weeks ago. A couple weeks or a month ago?
Month ago.
About a month ago, yeah. Okay, let's not belabor this. What is Heat? So, if you go and Google the definition for the project and stuff like that, it says Heat is a service to orchestrate multiple composite cloud formula applications, blah, 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 whatever, right? That's not the most exciting thing to read through in the moment. So I rewrote that. So Heat allows you to predefine a set of compute, network, and storage requirements to provide a specific service, and you can deploy the whole thing automatically.
My plan was to actually have a pocket.
That was supposed to be a woo going on right there, and it just didn't come out of my throat.
Yeah. My plan was to have a bunch of confetti, and when he said automatic, I was gonna whoosh. But
yeah, thanks. I appreciate you not actually doing that. Okay. So why is it called Heat? Heat makes clouds rise. Ah, I get it. You're bringing up your services. As far as open source project names goes, that's actually not half bad. you know, trying to get to where Neutron comes into a software-defined networking is a little bit more difficult. I'm sure somebody really thought it was obvious at some point, but even before when it was called quantum, it still wasn't readily obvious what it did. So there's two different formats that that are available if you're going to program for heat, and there's reasons to use both of them. The first one is that Heat was designed to be fully compatible with the CloudFormations service on Amazon AWS. With the benefit being then that you could use this template either on AWS or on your local OpenStack infrastructure, and you would not have to rewrite it each time. You would be able to use a common template between those, and that can save you a lot of time. We're not going to actually do the AWS stuff today. But I did want you to know that it is there, and it is something that you can use. And if you are an Amazon user, it can be quite helpful for you. Reduce your duplication of resources. Then there, the other methodology is the Heat Orchestration Template. I don't know why I keep looking over my shoulder this way when it's sitting right here in front of me, but it's a force of habit. So the other one is the Heat Orchestration Template, or HOT. This is a YAML-based template. And that's what we're going to be using for the exercises today. Who here is familiar with YAML? Just by way of shit. Oh, yeah. Wow, that's a great.
Okay, good. Yeah, so you guys already know, mind your spaces.
That's right. Mind your spacing. Over the 2-3 years I've been doing this, that it's like 99% of the questions that people have come down to they indented two spaces instead of three, or three instead of four, or something like that. Exciting. Okay, so getting back to weird open source project names, YAML stands for YAML ain't a markup language because somebody wanted to be recursive in their naming.
That's so meta.
Good for them. So you can see that it's a structured via indentation right here. So spacing, as Sean was just pointing out, counts quite a bit in here because that's how it's kind of like Python, and that's how you delineate your control structures and whatnot.
If it helps anybody, just think 2, 4, 6, 8. Who do we appreciate? Sousa.
I'm not following you on that one, man. Where did that come from? Oh, I say 2 spaces, 4 spaces. Oh, okay. There we go. Okay, I got you. Okay, here.
Go on. That was clever.
Yeah, sure it was. Okay. All right. So it's structured via indentation. Your sequence items are going to be denoted by a dash. That means if you're going to have multiple values assigned to something, you're going to have a dash, and then you'll have your key value pairs. And key value pairs within a map are separated by a colon. And that sounds not terribly intuitive, but it'll make more sense as you go through the exercises and get used to looking at. Once you get used to looking at YAML, it's actually a very easy to read, and it's it's much nicer than something. It's much better than something like XML that's just going to drive you crazy. All right. So just to get an idea of what we're going to walk through a couple of things that we're going to do in the exercises. The first thing is we're going to do just our basic kind of a hello world thing where we're going to use the OS Nova server resource type to just launch up a single instance. We're not going to assign it any special networking. We're not going to do anything special with it. Just kind of bring it up, see that it's there, feel proud of our achievements, and then we'll bring it down and go on to the next next little thing.
And please refer to the documentation that's on the host, not that slide, because the template name or the KVM image name has changed. So fair warning on that.
Oh, did you mess that up? Yeah. I had Sean, he was my beta tester this afternoon to make sure this stuff was all working. And so, yeah, the slides are here just to kind of give them a view of the format, not necessarily to be the reference for them. The next thing you can do is once you have, you know, the ability to declare those resources, oftentimes you're going to want to have some sort of variable input from your users. And that you can get via parameters, you know, standard programming type stuff. So you define in there, you have... You can define the type of your parameter. In this case, these are strings. You can give it a label if you want, description. And that the Heat engine, when you go and load it up in the web interface, will actually pull that out and give you nice pretty text boxes and all that kind of stuff for users to be able to put their stuff into it. So pretty easy to get yourself some parameters. And then you can see down here in the resources that, for example, the key name does a get parameter on the key name to be able to pull that in there, and you can use that as a reference. Again, if you've done programming, this is fairly basic stuff. Not everybody has done that, though, so we do need to cover it a little bit. You can do additional things beyond doing the parameters themselves. You can, what was I trying to do here?
There's multiple types.
I think, here we go. The big thing here is that down at the bottom of the password, you notice that there's a hidden colon true. So if you're going to have something that you do want to have, you know, those little stars instead of showing up on there, say root password or your social security number for if you are stupid enough to put that into your application, you can put the hidden colon true on there, and that will take care of it for you. And the other thing in the top one is you can set defaults. Pretty straightforward. You can also do restricting user input, because as everybody knows, if you let users type in whatever they want, the things that they type in will not make any sense whatsoever. I wish I thought ahead of time to go and get that XKCD comic with the little Bobby tables. Anybody remember that one? Okay, good. That was a great one, wasn't it? I tried sharing that with my friends on Facebook once a couple of years ago, and it just went over their head at 10,000 feet and climbing. So I like having an audience like that where you can bring it up and people like this, where you can bring it up and people understand it. And I thought I silenced my Google Hangouts, but apparently not. So, all right. allowed values. So in the top one, we're actually setting specific values. In this case, we're picking flavors of what we're going to launch up our instances to be, what size instances we're going to launch up. And you can see right here we're restricting it to a specific, this one's going to be restricting it to larger values. In our case, right here, because we are doing these on these smaller laptops and there's a fair number of people in here, I've actually limited you, and there's only one flavor allowed, which is the M1 Tiny, as small as it goes. And then you can see also on the password section down here, you can even go into allowed patterns if you know your regular expressions. That means you're awesome. You can go in there and you can define out how, the patterns, if you need to have a certain number of spaces and characters, or if you're going to be the password Nazi that makes you have a 20-character thing that rotates every 2 days, and you can't have more than 3 repeating characters or something like that. I'm not very happy with our corporate IT right now. They changed their password policies. I had the same password for like 6 years, and now I have to change it all the time. So that's me complaining. All right, so let's talk a little bit about the Docker pieces here. Who here is familiar with Docker? I would hope that at this point, if you've been at this conference all week long, that you've at least heard the name Docker. If you haven't, that means you didn't pay attention to any of the keynotes. I can't really help you at that point. In the context of Heat, there's two different resource types that you can use to create Docker instances. One is one that was contributed as a third-party plugin by Docker Inc. To be able to actually create Docker containers. And then there's the traditional OS Nova server, like we saw in the example I had earlier. And we'll talk in just a second about that. And as soon as we get done with the presentation, I'm going to kill that Hangout and figure out why it's still putting up notifications. One heads up, if you are going to be doing Docker with your in your own setups at home, note that your glance image name must be the same as the name when the image is in Docker, right? If you do a Docker images, it'll say like SUSE/12SP1 or whatever. Your image name in glance has to be the same as that name. Otherwise, it'll start to launch up, but then it'll stall out, and Docker will complain, and then everybody hates you. So don't do that.
And also, hats off to Cameron and Al, who have now been basically yelling at the people on the Hangout.
These are jerks. So two of my coworkers are here in their front two rows, and they're the ones that are throwing up all the stuff up there. Thanks, guys. Oh, thanks. Yeah, go me. See, you didn't know that you were coming for the comedy show today. All right, so So Doc, the one from Docker Inc. We're not going to be using this one today, because primarily for the last bullet point right there. But basically, what this one does is it tells you have to have a base image that you have sitting in your client's repository, and you need to. It will actually launch up that image as a standard VM, and then it will do a Docker pull and pull your containers from a Docker repository over into that system and launch them up, and they're all clustered there together, nice and tidy on their own individual VM. I'm not necessarily a big, huge fan of this methodology, because to me it's a huge waste of resources. One of the whole points of Docker is that, you know, by using the layered file systems and overlapping and all that kind of stuff, you can get a lot better performance than you would if you were just doing virtual machines. If you're going to throw the virtual machine in there, you could kill that entire point of doing that. I guess it means you don't have to launch multiple virtual machines, but still. It is good, though, if you're in some sort of industry where there's some sort of compliance, whether it's PCI or whether it's HIPAA, or if you're doing government work and you need to be compatible with that. There are times when they require strict separation of resources. And that would be a good reason, I would think, to be able to do it this way. Otherwise, for most of the Docker instances, I would just let them sit on a dedicated Docker host so you can get the best performance out of that. Thanks, Al. He's explaining to my other coworkers across the country that I was an idiot and left my Hangouts up. I know that not all of you can read those up there in the corner. I don't want to lose my microphone. All right, the other one, the OS Nova server. This is really nice because, this is the one that uses a dedicated Docker Compute node. So in that sense, to the Nova scheduler, it's just like any other hypervisor, and it works the same. The benefit here is you don't have that virtualization overhead, especially if you have a lot of images that are based off of a single base image. You can get some really great efficiency in your use of your resources, and you can really pack in a lot of workloads onto a single system. did I leave something out? Dedicated, no overhead. Look at that, I got it all. Seems like there's something else. The nice thing about this as well, and I didn't put this in the bullet points, is that if you're using the OS Nova server template types and you decide that you want to switch from Docker to something else or something to Docker, you don't have to rewrite your heat templates. If you're using the standard stuff right here, then it makes it very easy to swap it out, and that way you can experiment with different platform architectures and not have to worry about bringing up your rewriting your heat templates to get there. Okay, just a couple resources, and again, I'm not expecting anybody to write this down right now. I am going to have these slides available on my laptop up here that you'll be able to download however many people are able to actually get onto my poor access point there in the middle of the room. We'll see how this goes. But these are two places where I found some good heat templates out there that I was able to use as a basis for doing my stuff there. Over the last couple of years, there's really been an expanding of the what's out there online, and some of it is even marginally relevant. So, yay. All right. So let's go ahead and let's do this, right?
If anybody has questions while doing the work, just raise your hand. I'll come down and I'll help you out the best I can.
All right. So for those of you who were not in when we were talked about the SSID, you want to be on the SUSE network, not the SUSE OS training. That is my colleague Ron Terry across the hall, and he probably would not appreciate it if we're sucking up all of his bandwidth. More importantly, though, you would not be able to access any of the resources here. Your Horizon dashboard is going to be at this IP address. So for users, what we're going to do is we're going to start here in the front row. Once Cameron gets off of his phone, Cameron, thank you. We're going to start saying numbers and going down, and basically that number is going to be part of your username. So if you're number one, you would be Austin1 with the password of Austin. We're going to see super creative right here. So let's just go ahead and start right here and number off and just go down and Let's see. Oh, you're not gonna do it. Okay, let's start with you, gentlemen, right there. So one, two. All right, let's come back up here. So that's 52 is the last back there. Start back up here in the front row, and hopefully we don't go past 99 because that's all I put in there. What? Start at 54? Okay, 54. 56. Okay, once we go past 99, once we know how many it is, I'll create additional users and spaces. 85. Okay, and that's my boss at the back of the room. He doesn't need to get on here. Okay, okay. So we ended up at 105. Was that? Okay. Let me go ahead and.
So that was actually a sneaky way to find out exactly how many people we have here.
That was really sneaky.
Super sneaky.
What's that?
That the counting off. That was our way to find out how many people were actually attending the session. Yeah. And just so you guys know. And one of our colleagues, I did a presentation with him, and he made a really good point. For this session, you can think of Rick as Wikipedia, and you can think of me more like a YouTube.
You're what?
More like a YouTube.
Oh, okay.
No, but I'm pretty obnoxious. So everybody go ahead and try to, yep, you got a question over there? The last slide? Can you bring up the last slide, Rick, please? And thank you.
So let me get the, here, let me see if I can. There you go.
So is anybody unable to connect to the Wi-Fi? You can't log in? Okay.
I'm not sure what my, I think I did 120 IP addresses on that thing, so hopefully. I mean, it's a small little Apple airport thing, so. Last time I did this class, I had 10 people. Time before that, I had like 50 or 60 or so, so I was not expecting 100, which is, it's great to have you here. It's just gonna take a second.
Is anybody else unable to log on to the console? You can't log on? No. Yeah, okay.
So Austin 74 can't log on.
What?
Austin 74. So I have to check the.
It was a password, it was a script, so if they check the. Go ahead and check it, make sure they did it right. Yeah. Okay, hold on a second. Thank you. The images are the Docker image is already imported in there. You should have them available to you. You should not need to go grab the Docker images. The KVM images that are in there, you're welcome to grab them to use in your own spare time later, amuse your kids with it. Cameron, there's a couple of hands going up back there, if you don't mind.
So there is a PDF on that server there, on the host, that has the lab manual. So feel free to pop that open and get started.
What? I'm about to have 110. Okay. I've created the users and I've created the in the tenants, but the projects, but I need to sign the roles real quick, and then they'll be ready to go. Give me a second, make sure that I get all this in here, and then we'll check that.
So for those who can't log in, just give us a second. We'll get that fixed up for you.
Okay. So for those of you who are over 99, you should be able to log in now with your credentials. What's that?
You do not want to do copy paste.
Okay, so I purposely left it a little bit difficult like that so that it forces you to interact with the text. If you just go through and copy and paste without really looking or reading it, you'll go through the lab really quickly, which is great for you, but you don't actually learn anything. So I'm... Exactly. But it teaches you, so that's the whole point. Okay, so we have specific users that are having problems. Let's go look at that.
So a couple of people have been asking me about this. If you get through the parsing of your YAML file and the actual creation fails, don't worry about it. You can actually just move on. We're not going to be going into the instances themselves. It's really just to see how the YAML file sets up the parameters.
Okay, I've gone through and I'm updating the quotas for everybody to give a little bit more resources available to you. However, please be responsible. If you have, once you get done with an exercise, terminate your stack. Don't sit there with multiple stacks open so we can leave resources available for other people. Okay, I ran a script earlier that supposedly was going to put the key pair that you needed for in there into each of the tenants, but apparently something is weird is happening, and not everybody is having those. I'm not sure how it would happen on part of them, but not all. If you don't have the key pair in there, just simply create a key pair through the interface, going through the access and security rules section and create a key pair. You can give it the same name as what I had and just put some random text in there, or you can create your own and then just adapt your resources when you're putting them in there.
So for the people that cannot log in, that you're getting the refresh when you're trying to put in your username and password, we're working on that right now. It should be fixed in the next couple minutes.
It could also be related to your web browser.
Yeah, it could also be related to your web browser as well.
If you're using Internet Explorer, don't.
So...
Just a second. Just for those of you who are having trouble logging in, the gentleman over here was using Edge as his browser, and that did not work. Once he switched to Chrome, he was fine. So if you're using Edge as your browser and you're having the issue with not being able to log in, then try a different browser. So there was one question up here about whether this stuff was SUSE specific or whether this is just general. All this is completely general. There's nothing SUSE specific about this.
So very quickly, I had this question come up a couple of times. So what you're deploying are actual Docker images. So the images that are that you are using are spinning up those Docker containers, and it's all running on a Docker rolled or Nova Docker in Crowbar. So there is a bug that's in the lab on purpose. So you will get there, and we actually set it up there so you guys can putter around and try to fix it. So it's a little bit of a hint. It's in the networking section of it. So you'll get to it, and if you have questions, just let us know.
So we've had a couple people ask, where's the Docker in all of this? Who here was wondering the same thing? Okay. So the point here, what I was trying to get across was that, remember I said there's the two different ways of doing it. I prefer to do it this way, where you're using the standard resources, and it's just everything you're doing is with Docker containers. It's just you're doing it using the standard resources. The benefit to that being that it makes it much more portable. My customers are all very large enterprises that have multiple hypervisors and platforms and stuff like that. And so by being able to use the common resources, that enables it so they can shift back and forth between them much easier without having to rewrite every time, which is why I decided to do it this way. That, and I feel like this is a much more efficient use of resources. If we were launching up VMs for everybody to do all this, the system would have cratered even a lot faster than it did already.